I'm Professor Christophe Cognard from Toulouse, the neuroradiologist, and we are here to discuss about the stroke therapy and the thrombectomy. So Anastasios Potsaris from Aachen, Germany, and we are going to discuss together about the new challenges in stroke therapy and thrombectomy. So Anastasios, for you, what are the new or the next challenges?
I think we are now in a comfortable situation, so we have proven in the large trials that it works, so we don't have to discuss about that point anymore. But I think there are three key challenges that remain, and I think we have to think about the time window, so how far can that go. We have to think about imaging, so how much detail do we need with that. And I think there's still room for improvement pertaining to the technique available. So let me ask you, because I work in Germany and you in France, so how about the time frames when we talk about everyday situations? So how do you deal with that? Do you think Dawn was probably too strict on patient selection with that?
So for us, Dawn was really a revolution for a while. We were never starting a thrombectomy after 6 hours. When we started participating to Dawn, then we realized that finally there are probably a lot of patients who could benefit from a thrombectomy after 6 hours up to 24. We were concerned about the fact that it could be more difficult to retrieve an old clot, that the technique could be more risky, less efficient, and the risk of bleed may be higher. And finally, the results of Dawn were absolutely fantastic, showing that you have the perfect efficacy of the thrombectomy from 6 to 24 hours with a need to treat which is even lower than the one of the need to treat in Hermes in the first 6 hours. So thrombectomy from 6 to 24 hours is extremely efficient. Maybe the point is that the criteria, it was your question, were too strict. I think they had to be strict because the study had to be positive.
Yeah.
So finally, they were too strict retrospectively because the volume of the infarct and the core infarct of the patients who were recruited in the study were very, very low. It was below 10 cc. And the need to treat is so low that it means that the thrombectomy works absolutely well from 6 to 24 hours. So now, in the routine practice, we have to treat patients with criteria that are different from that which were used in Dawn and Diffuse 3. And the problem is up to which volume of core we should still do the thrombectomy from 6 to 24 hours. We don't know, but Dawn has opened a huge avenue, and definitely we should not keep with those very strict criteria that we are using Dawn.
A lot of colleagues in Germany kept asking me after this data came out, how complicated does it have to be with the imaging? So is it okay to go, because there were very strict imaging criteria in both Diffuse 3 and Dawn, would it be okay to lessen the grip on that? So should we go more for plain CT, or shall we measure in the 17th hour really the core? I mean, from a scientific point of view, that's obvious because that's what the trial showed. But from a practical point of view, what would be the recommendation? How should we probably proceed?
I would say that for a known onset time stroke, within the first 6 hours, we need very limited imaging. We just need to know that it's not a bleed and there is a large vessel occlusion. And finally, the technique is so efficient that we don't need to know more. In after 6 hours up to 24, I don't have the answer. I would say that in Aurora, which is gathering Diffuse 3, Dawn, and three other studies, RCTs in which patients were included after 6 hours, you still have a huge benefit, even those patients who are just selected on regular CT scans. So I'm not sure we need such a sophisticated imaging, even from 6 to 24 hours. The problem is then we should not treat all patients from 6 to 24. Maybe just the aspect score is enough to decide to do a thrombectomy after 6 hours. That has to be more precisely evaluated. About the technique itself, because I know that you are interested in the technique and in the SAFE technique. What does SAFE mean exactly?
Well, actually it's an acronym because people love acronyms, so we're in the age of acronyms. It means stent retriever, assisted vacuum locked extraction, so which describes quite clearly what we want to do. We want to grab the clot from distally. We want to have distal protection beyond the clot with a stent retriever, which is the perfect tool for that. And we want to have a proximal grip on the clot, and for that aspiration is, in my opinion, and what the data shows that we now have compiled from 4 German centers, is the most efficient way to do it. So we think that we should raise the first pass efficacy rate. So I think TC2B used to be good in the beginnings when we had to prove that the technique works, but right now I think we can do better and should aim at becoming better. And another very important point for me is that one of the oldest tools we have around, which is the balloon guide catheter, and you have always been happy with balloon guide catheters, I think, in France. In Germany, it was a point to really persuade people with good data. And now we have that available, and it shows that the balloon guide really delivers the extra punch you need, I think.
We often discuss the fact that stent is better than aspiration. You do both?
Yes, I do both. I jumped beyond that point with my team and said, let's let them discuss. We just use both. And because we were very experienced with both methods, so we started with stent retrieving, then switched to aspiration, published a lot on that, but we also saw the drawbacks. So aspiration sometimes just does not finish the job. And you know, the more experienced you become, the more lazy, in a good way, you probably become. So you want to finish quickly and go back home in the night or whenever. So that was the motivation, a very basic motivation, to create a method that really resolves nearly every second case in just one try.
But as well, we often discuss whether we should use a balloon guide cat or not. So you do both distal aspiration and proximal aspiration into a balloon guide cat.
Yes. Of course, the problem is that we do not have flow reversal. I would love to have flow reversal, but that's something that we have to look into the future as a development. Right now, I just have flow arrest by inflating the balloon in the ICA. I think that from the preliminary data we have, that this might be beneficial, even if we don't reach yet flow reversal. But this has to be shown, and I would love to have some bigger catheters in the near future, which leave enough space between the intermediate catheter and the balloon guider to have aspiration there as well. So we do a two-point aspiration, but I think we can also improve on that as well, which would be a point for the future.
So with the SAFE technique, finally, the success of the first pass is how much and compared to the other studies?
Our preliminary, our data now, so we are beyond the preliminary stage. In the preliminary, in the pilot study, it was as high as 70%, but we knew that we would not be able to keep up to that because numbers were small. So we pulled together prospectively 200 patients in 4 centers, experienced people. We did a centralized reading, and now we have a 45% rate of first pass efficacy, so a true first pass phenomenon. And this is nearly twice as high as you can get at the moment with plain stent retriever techniques. So the registries, NASA, TREK and so on, have shown that the first pass efficacy with a stent retriever alone is 25%. So my aim is to, through technical perfection, double that number.
That's very, very interesting and very promising technique. I thank you very much, Anastasios.
And, you're welcome, and thank you as well.
And it was really a pleasure.
Thank you, Christophe.